Mickey and Jim Ford for the lighting of our Advent candle.
Today is the third Sunday in Advent. We're halfway along our journey.
Together, let us shout for joy at the glory of our Lord, when the eyes of the blind will be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped.
God invites us to make this journey to God's kingdom, traveling through the wilderness on his holy highway.
Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, that God may teach us his ways and that we may walk in his paths. We travel towards God in great joy. As we live in God's promise, let us light these candles. Loving God, come and shine your light in the world. Let us pray together.
Faithful God,
we are glad for your promises to us.
We trust that
time is coming when all people will experience joy and gladness through you.
May we do our part
to bring your good news to all.
Amen.
welcome each of you to worship at First Presbyterian Church, and of course say a special word of welcome to anyone who may be visiting with us for the first time, as well as all of you worshiping with us online. If you'd like to connect further with our church, do please fill out one of the visitor cards in the pew rack in front of you, or speak to the minister or any of us after the service today. Some announcements for this morning: a reminder that prayer group meets on Tuesdays at 4 p.m. Everyone is invited to join them. And of course, thinking to our friends in Clarksville who suffered significant damage in the tornadoes, we did receive correspondence from the Reverend Greg Glover earlier this week. He is the pastor of First Presbyterian Church in Clarksville, and he wrote to us, "We are accepting donations marked tornado for direct assistance with hotel rooms and food, online or by check. Other partners are coordinating clothing, etc. We expect to have a better picture of the size and scope of the need as the days pass, but we are also assessing intermediate term housing needs, hoping to have families out of hotels and placed into homes before Christmas. So if you would like to assist with that effort, you can do so and visit with Sherard about how to specifically do that. Just a reminder, there will be no fellowship meals while school is out, so we will not gather on December 20th, December 27th, or January 3rd, but we will resume regular meals on January 10th. I do believe today's the last day to order poinsettias. Is that correct? So if you've not done that and want to do that, there should be a form in your bulletin. Is there any other information that needs to be shared with the congregation at this time? Hearing none, let us prepare our hearts and minds to worship God.
Thank you, Jessica. When we come here to worship God, the first thing we have to do is remember who we are. And we are people who sin. We sin often and we turn away from the ways of the Lord. So let us now rely not on ourselves, but on God's abundant grace, and join with me in sharing a confession of our sins before God and one another. Let us confess our sins together. God, our Savior, despite our numerous faults, you continue to look on us with your favor. We are merciful while we are callous. You are strong while we gravitate toward bullies. You are just while we claim everything for ourselves. Forgive us and lead us each day to become your humble servants. Help us to magnify your holy presence to this hungry world so that all may savor your glory. Amen. Our assurance of pardon. Hear the good news. Jesus came to save sinners. May we be dead to sin and alive to God. In the name of Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Let us stand. Remember that Jesus Christ is truly the peace of our lives. May all we do in his most holy name. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
We're correcting a little oversight. Earlier in the year, we installed officers. I mean, earlier this year, Rachel wasn't able to be here, and we just kept not doing it. And she's been serving diligently, but we need to correct that and install her as a deacon. She has served as a deacon before, so we will keep this simple. But we're thankful for your year of service already, and we're glad to have you. Yeah. I have several constitutional questions to ask you, Rachel. First of all, do you trust in Jesus Christ, your Savior? Acknowledge him Lord of all and head of the church, and through him believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? If so, say, I do. Will you fulfill your ministry in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? If so, say, I will. Will you be governed by our church's polity, and will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit? If so, say, I will. Will you, in your own life, seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? If so, say, I will. Do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church? If so, say, I do. And finally, will you be a faithful deacon? Will you continue to be a faithful deacon, teaching charity, urging concern, and directing the people's help to the friendless and those in need? And in your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? If so, say, I will. And for you, members of the congregation, I have two questions. Do we, the members of this church, accept Rachel as a deacon chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead us in the way of Jesus Christ? If so, say, we do.
We do.
Do we agree to pray for her, to encourage her to respect her decisions, and to follow as she guides us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is head of the church? If so, say, we do.
We do.
Let us pray. Lord God Almighty, we give thanks for Rachel and all the other officers of this church who have been called to service as deacons and elders. But make Rachel modest and humble and strong and constant. Let her life so reflect your commandments that through her, many may come to know you and to love you. Rachel, you are now a deacon in the Church of Jesus Christ and for this congregation. Whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, giving thanks to the Father through him. Welcome. Congratulations. And you have this. Thank you. Give her an applause. Please join with me in our prayer for illumination. Let us pray. Speak to us, Lord. Speak to us in the waiting, the watching, the hoping, the longing, the sorrow, the sighing, the rejoicing. Speak to us by your word in these Advent days, and walk with us until the day of your coming. Amen. Our reading for this third Sunday of Advent comes to us from the Gospel of Luke. We continue reading through the Gospel of Luke for our sermon series, Christmas Through the Eyes of Mary. And today we are reading the Magnificat. And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on, all generations will call me blessed. For the mighty one has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts.
He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever. This is the word of the Lord. Many of you will be familiar with the scripture reading for today by its informal title, the Magnificat. The title comes from the first word of the text when it's read in Latin from the Vulgate Bible, because that first word is indeed Magnificat. Magnificat anima mea dominum. My soul magnifies the Lord. Magnificat clearly means to magnify. Now, this text, this Magnificat, is most likely a hymn, one of the oldest hymns that we have in the New Testament. Some call it Mary's Psalm. And it is a hymn likely that Luke's congregation, Luke the writer of this gospel, it's likely a hymn that they knew and were familiar with. Maybe they even sang it during worship services. And Luke, like any good writer, recognize when somebody else's words just said it better. I mean, it's no different than me citing, "A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing." Those aren't words I would ever say. Those aren't words I could even dream up. But they express that feeling of God's mightiness so wonderfully that we sing those words here as a hymn. So the Magnificat is likely a song the people sang. Does that mean that Mary didn't say this? She certainly said something like this. It captures her feeling for God and who she is. The Gospel of Luke, as we've been reading these past couple of weeks, begins with the story of Zechariah and Elizabeth, an older couple who are visited by an angel and told that they will have a son. The son will become John the Baptist. 6 months after the angel saw Elizabeth and Zechariah, he goes to Mary. Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph. And the angel said, "Greetings, favored one. The Lord is with you." And this young woman, Mary, she was perplexed by these words. What does it mean that the Lord is with me? What does it mean that I am favored? The angel goes on, "Do not be afraid, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive and bear a son. You will name him Jesus. He will be great. He will be called Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." And you can imagine that she was indeed perplexed by those words. For who would say that to a young girl who wasn't even married yet? That she's going to have this child that is going to have a kingdom. The angel then tells her about her cousin Elizabeth, who is older and has never had children, and they didn't think she could. So Mary responds then with the words that are the foundation of this series of sermons I've been preaching. She said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." This tells us everything about Mary. It tells us about her faith, and it tells us about her commitment to God. "Here am I, the servant of the Lord." So, having said this, Mary travels to see Elizabeth. And when she comes to Elizabeth's house, the child in Elizabeth's belly, it jumps, it kicks. And Elizabeth is filled with the Holy Spirit. She is changed. And in turn, she calls Mary blessed. And Mary then responds with this passage for today, the Magnificat. Now, if any of you have been part of the Catholic Church for any period of time, you know that the Catholic view of Mary, well, they have a very high view of Mary. Mary is the mother of Christ, the wife of God. Mary is a saint. Mary is someone that we pray to. In fact, the Roman Catholics ascribe to a doctrine known as the Assumption of Mary, which says that Mary didn't die, but at the end of her life, she was carried body and soul, physically and spiritually, into heaven to live with her son forever. And during the Middle Ages, some in the church argued that Mary should be part of the Trinity to make it a four-person body: Father, Mother, Son, and Spirit. And there's a certain logic to that. We as Protestants, we look at Mary in a different light. We take a rather lower view of her. And really, at best, we just tend to ignore her. We're not quite sure what to do with the figure of this young woman who gave birth to Christ. And it's probably a disservice to the person of Mary, for she is indeed a crucial figure in the story of our faith. But it doesn't matter what Protestants believe. It doesn't matter what Catholics believe. What's important is what Luke believed. Luke, the writer of this gospel, how did he view Mary? And for Luke, Mary is the idealized servant of God. Really, there is no one more giving than this young woman in all the stories. She is called by God through the archangel Gabriel. And when called and given this incredible task of carrying the Son of God, she responds, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." She gives of herself wholly, not quite sure what the future is going to bring her, but she gives. And everything that Mary says or does, I believe, should be filtered through those words, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord." She accepts God's call. She obeys God's will. And sadly, as a servant, she will suffer as well. She will witness her son's rejection and his execution. And this is something that no mother would want to experience. Our reading for today begins with those words, "My soul magnifies the Lord." And this commitment on Mary's part is a reminder that the ultimate task of a servant of God, of any servant of God, is to declare God's greatness to the world. Would that all of our souls magnified God's holy presence. And then Mary recounts how God found favor with her. I mean, why does she feel favor? She's been given this task that is going to be so difficult and will take over her life. In fact, the life that she had planned, you know, quietly marrying Joseph and living in Nazareth, that's been taken away. She's been given a new life, and yet she feels favored by this. And she even talks about how God has looked with favor on her lowliness. Lowliness. We talk about Mary as being this young, innocent, naive girl from a small village in Galilee, which is in a small country on the edge of the Roman Empire, that she is powerless, that she is at the bottom of the ladder. But that is not what makes her lowly. No, her lowliness stems from her humility. Because when she looks at God, God whom she calls the Mighty One, she is able to recognize the great discrepancy between her and God. She recognizes that God is God and that she is but a person. Not all of us have that gift. Some have hearts that are so filled with pride, they look at God and they view themselves as equal. "Hey, God, how you doing?" Mary's humility is her strength. Her humility sets her apart from so many people. Now, the Magnificat really could have just ended right there. "Here I am, a servant. I am lowly. I am humbled. God is great." That would be enough. But it doesn't stop there. It keeps going. And now it becomes a song that is radical, that is revolutionary. In fact, this prayer, this song, the Magnificat, is a part of Scripture that is cherished by the marginalized people of this world. And in fact, it is banned in some countries with authoritarian leaders. In places where the poor are trampled, they read these words as God's promise of hope. For it is nothing less than a declaration of justice. It proclaims how God is going to bring down the powerful and lift up the lowly. It proclaims how God will feed the hungry and also send the rich away empty. These are statements most of the world doesn't want to hear. And why is it that God does these things? God does these things because of the promise that God made with Abraham, that covenant to watch over us, to care for us, to love us. Not just the wealthy and powerful, but the lowly, the despised, the hungry, the powerless. God cannot love just some. God loves all. And justice
is evidence of God's love. Now today is the third Sunday of the season of Advent, and Advent is that time when we are reminded that we are to prepare ourselves for the coming of God's glorious kingdom through the birth of Jesus Christ. And what better way to prepare for Advent than to magnify the work of God in this world? Now, preparing is not just words that we say. Preparing is serving. It is doing acts of compassion. It is sheltering the homeless and feeding the hungry and visiting the forgotten. It is doing all those things by which we might magnify God's love to this world. The star that shines over us at Christmas is a sign of God's love. And through our acts, we can make that light even brighter so that all may know the glory of the Lord. As I've mentioned, the Magnificat is not some safe little statement of praise. It is subversive. It is radical. It is a protest. It is a dangerous message of hope to the downtrodden. It's a warning to the world that this coming birth will be world-transforming, universe-shaking. For the poor, for the oppressed, for those at the fringes, this is the good news that God cares about them. This Christ will challenge the structures of this world, structures that are built on sin and evil and death, structures that are built on power and pride. And this Christ who is to come will lift up the fallen, pull down the haughty, bring justice to the oppressed. It's a message that we find many times in Scripture, not just here. It's a message that we find in the songs that we sing on Sunday morning, including one by Edmund Sears, "It Came Upon a Midnight Clear." Hear this verse. "And yea, beneath life's crushing load, whose forms are bending low, who toil along the climbing way with painful steps and slow, look now, for glad and golden hours come swiftly on the wing. O rest beside the weary road and hear the angels sing." In this time of Advent, I urge you to listen for the words of those angels who call out to us to be humble and to magnify the light of the Lord. Amen.
Glory to God. Rejoice, rejoice.
Let's remain standing as together we affirm what we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed. Let us confess together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended
into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty.
Thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Let us pray. In this holiday season, we find many demands that are made upon our time and our resources. And yet in worship, we are called to remember the one who is the author of all who we are and all that we have. And so in response to your gracious actions in your lives, O God, we bring our offerings to you. Amen. Your offering will now be taken. Please be seated. would like to take a moment now to offer a prayer and a dedication for our pledges. Many of you have submitted pledge cards for 2024, and these are important, for they are a sign of your commitment to God and to the church. It is a discipline that we take part in each year. And we use your pledges to plan the ministry of this congregation. If you have not had the opportunity to turn your card in, you can bring it to the office or bring it next week. But we accept those that we receive today, and we offer them with thanks. So let us pray. Creator of all, the earth is yours and the world and all who live in it. You have entrusted us with gifts, time, talent, energy, and money, and you have asked us to use them to build your kingdom. We bring these gifts as our pledge for the future. We offer ourselves, our lives, our hopes and fears, our dollars and our hours. And we commit ourselves to work for the coming of your realm, to love and serve wherever you call. We ask your blessings on this, your church, as we seek to follow you with heart and mind and soul. Almighty God, bless these gifts and pledges that they will reflect your kingdom in this world. Amen. And now we continue with our prayer together, and there's one prayer that I'd like to lift up, and that is received news yesterday that Jack Emmert's son-in-law, his daughter's wife, died suddenly yesterday, and so they have gone down to Florida for the week, and we want to keep their family in our prayers. The young man's name is Chris Prouty. Let us open our hearts and turn to God. Let us pray. God of Advent, you promised to come again in restoration and wholeness, and we acknowledge that our needs are not that different from those of peoples of long ago. For we too wander in darkness, and we too yearn for your light to come into our lives. And so, trusting in Christ, we bring our prayers to you for this world. And we pray for a world that is shaped by so much sin. We pray that those who are oppressed will be set free, that those who are bound by injustice will find a new life. We pray that those whose lives are plagued by violence will find freedom. We ask that you help us form this world more closely into the image of your kingdom. Help us be faithful, O God, in things big and small, so that we might be your people in this world. And we pray for those who are sick, and those who are lonely, and those who are without hope. We pray that you will grant them the sure and certain knowledge of your love and care. And may we, as your people, be a community that indeed cares and heals. And for those who grieve and those who are near to death, we ask special blessings in their lives. Holy God, we come before you this day, and we pray for the family of Chris Prouty over their sudden loss yesterday. Be with all their family so that they may know your loving spirit and know that they are in our prayers. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Friends, what are your prayers this day? Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
My sister Cheryl, who's back in the hospital.
Lord, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Robert Bowen.
Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For Rachel Robinson, who is in rehabilitation after a year in hospice.
Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Almighty God, we continue to pray for those whose lives were torn apart by the tornadoes last week. Let us not forget them and the pain that they are suffering. And we pray that all will be able to build their lives back as quickly as possible. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
And let us now continue praying, using the words that Jesus taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us stand for our medley. and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, both this day and forevermore. And all the people said, Amen.